Hello, Dr. Carlo Oyer for edexitvideo.com. In this video, we're going to talk about phlegmasia cerulea dolens. In the United States, more than 500,000 cases of VTE, venous thromboembolism, occur every year. Pulmonary embolisms complicate approximately 50% of the cases of untreated DVT and complicates 10 to 15% of all hospital deaths. Less frequent manifestations of venous thrombosis include phlegmasia alba dolens, phlegmasia cerulea dolens, PCD, and venous gangrene. These are actually a continuum of the same disorders. All three manifestations result from acute massive venous thrombosis and obstruction of the venous drainage of an extremity. Let me give you a little history lesson here. In the 1500s, Mr. Hildenus first described the clinical syndrome of what is currently called PCD. In 1938, Gregor made an outstanding description of the condition and used the term PCD to differentiate ischemia-associated massive venous thrombosis from phlegmasia alba dolens, which describes fulminant venous thrombosis without ischemia. In 1939, Lerich performed the first thrombectomy for cases of PCD. Historically, surgical thrombectomy has been the procedure of choice for treatment of PCD, refractory to medical therapy and in patients with established or impending gangrene. So why does PCD happen? The main causative factor in phlegmasia is massive thrombosis and occlusion of the major venous channels, significantly compromising the venous outflow. Multiple triggering factors exist. Malignancy is the most common triggering factor and is present in 40% of patients with PCD. Other risk factors include hypercoagulable syndrome, surgery, trauma, ulcerative colitis, gastroenteritis, heart failure, mitral valve stenosis, vena cava filter insertion, and pregnancy has been associated with phlegmasia alba dolens, especially during the third trimester, when the uterus is large enough to compress the left common iliac vein against the pelvic ring. This is called milk leg syndrome. Finally, 10% of patients with phlegmasia have no apparent risk factors. In phlegmasia alba dolens, alba means white in Latin, the thrombosis involves only major venous channels of the extremity, therefore sparing the collateral veins. The venous drainage is decreased but still present. The lack of venous congestion differentiates this entity from PCD. In phlegmasia cerulea dolens, the thrombosis extends to the collateral veins, resulting in venous congestion with massive fluid sequestration and more significant edema and swelling. These phases are reversible if proper measures are taken. Of phlegmasia cerulea dolens cases, 40 to 60% have capillary involvement, which results in irreversible venous gangrene that involves the skin, subcutaneous tissue, or muscle. Under this condition, the hydrostatic pressure in the arterial and venous capillaries exceeds the oncotic pressure, causing a lot of fluid to go to that extremity. Involvement of the upper extremities occurs in less than 5% of patients with phlegmasia cerulea dolens. Manifestations may be gradual or fulminant. Of PCD cases, 50 to 60% are preceded by alba dolens, with symptoms of edema, pain, and blanching without cyanosis. The blanching, which was previously thought to be caused by arterial vasospasm, is actually caused by subcutaneous edema without venous congestion. Patients with PCD present with a clinical triad of edema, agonizing pain, and cyanosis. Massive fluid sequestration may lead to bleb and bulla formation, big blisters. And it starts from compression of the venous at the pelvic region. When venous gangrene occurs, it has a similar distribution to the cyanosis. Arterial pulses may be present when the venous gangrene is superficial. However, gangrene that involves the muscular compartment may result in increased compartment pressures and a pulse deficit. In addition, the pulses may be difficult to appreciate because of the significant edema. Various degrees of shock may be present because of the significant fluid loss to the extremity. Historically, surgical thrombectomy has been the procedure of choice for the treatment of PCD, that is refractory to medical therapy and for patients with established or impending gangrene. The standard treatment of phlegmasia and venous gangrene is evolving, but most clinicians attempt endovascular approaches to thrombolysis if possible. For phlegmasia alba dolens, the mild, non-gangrenous form of phlegmasia cerulea dolens, Conservative medical treatment rather than surgical thrombectomy should be the initial course of therapy. This means pain medication, fluids, anticoagulants like heparin and Coumadin. Thrombolysis, which usually means intravenous tPA, may be initiated if conservative management does not elicit a response and if the patient has no contraindication to lytic therapy. Surgical thrombectomy cannot open the small venules that affect the venous ganglion, and it does not prevent valvular incompetence or post-phlebitic syndrome. For these reasons, thrombolysis seems to be an attractive alternative in the management of PCED and venous ganglion.